Let's now discuss prospects for the local bourse. Looking ahead, the path looks bright for the stock market with a looming rate cut from the central bank expected to drive trading. Let's continue our discussion with Union Bank Investment and Trust Corporation SVP Julian Tarubago and Serge Zandueta, Portfolio Manager of COL Investment Management. So, what's your outlook for the next 6 months, June?
Well, we think rate cuts by the central bank will fuel a local driven rally in the Philippines, and we think foreign participation will be limited because of the foreign exchange uncertainties. So it will be a local driven rally. We think that rally will have stronger legs if you see the 10-year GS, for example, drop to 6% or lower. Then you will see an acceleration of the rally as institutional fund managers or institutional funds then are incentivized to shift from fixed income allocate into equities when rates fall below 6%. And that we think would be the driver for a more meaningful rally in equities, perhaps towards year-end. As liquidity improves and as foreign exchange risk is priced in, we think then the foreigners will come in and they help add more legs to the rally. Of course, this is barring any major geopolitical fallout. There are many, and those are risks definitely worth considering. But from a risk return standpoint, at this point rather, if we're the first quarter earnings were actually quite good, better than expected. We saw earnings grow 14%. So the earnings story is intact for the Philippines. Valuations are attractive, below 11 times 2024 earnings. Fundamental story is intact. The liquidity is not. Market liquidity is obviously a hindrance to big money coming in. But then again, when sentiment improves, liquidity improves. When liquidity improves, you get the bigger players coming in at much higher levels. Then you get the IPO cycle starting already, and there is no dearth of potential strong IPOs out there. You've got Mint or GCash, you've got the SM Prime REIT, and you have, I believe, Prime Infrastructure also waiting in the wings. So there's no dearth of quality IPOs that could add depth to the Philippine equity market, a depth we all urgently need. So there are positive factors, but at the same time, fully cognizant of the risks in the short term. But for any investor looking to looking at very good asymmetrical returns, meaning limited downside versus upside, again, barring any geopolitical fallout, I think these are good entry levels for the Philippines.
What about you, Serge? Do you agree with the view of June on the local market? And you know, that said, I mean, what are possible risks that you see?
I actually agree a lot in terms of what Mr. Tarubago mentioned. I think there's a good chance.
Pangulan.
Right. I agree with June's take. Definitely, I think valuations for the market are attractive. And I think there's really scope for us to at least just go back baseline, like it's a 10% earnings growth this year for market to grow 10% also from its closing level last year. So I think 7.1 is achievable. I think the path to get there could be a bit volatile. I think what's going on at the moment is a lot of people are probably pulling forward pricing in a lot of the positives from the Fed rate cut, so much so that when they do it, it's possible you see a temporary sell the news type of blip. But like I say, maybe towards the fourth quarter, you see, and you add in the seasonality also, third quarter tends to be more volatile for the year. Then you add in the fourth quarter, boost from the fourth quarter, then I think we could see that strength towards year end. In terms of the risks, I think it ties back also to the issues we brought up with regard to the peso. So I think if you come up with that scenario that the BSP does indeed cut in August, but then for some reason Jerome Powell changes his mind and doesn't cut in September, then I think that could put pressure again on the currency and we could be left hanging. So that's, I think that that's one. And then on the earnings front, I'm not sure if like I say, the consumer side could recover materially already moving forward. Although if there's a peaking of inflation, then definitely that should help. And but I'm on the lookout, like in terms of earnings, just in case there could be some disappointments on that front. So those are the two that's still on my mind on the risk standpoint. And then of course geopolitical issues, but that's something that we also could never forecast.
Finally, for my last question, may I ask your thoughts on which sectors investors should focus on? So let me begin with you, June. You had mentioned, the unloved sectors like property. I mean, any other sectors that you're watching out for or that you're monitoring right now?
Right. Thanks, April. So aside from the obvious beneficiary property, like you mentioned earlier, two sectors we think will do quite well or will continue, well, two will do quite well. One is telecommunications, wherein there are, there's value in Globe in particular. You're seeing improvements in the mobile business. And there seems to be a lot of hype in terms of, well, not hype, but optimism in terms of the value of the data center assets. And at the end of the day, you have the opportunity or the optionality to monetize the value of what is emerging. I mean, for them, Gcash is now, I heard, synonymous with e-wallet. So that IPO would, I think, generate or create or realize quite a lot of shareholder value. So you've got improvements on the operating side, optionality in terms of valuing its assets. It holds, so there's a lot of upside on that front. And consumer, you mentioned unloved. We do hundreds of company visits every year, and early this year, the most said term in those meetings has been down trading, and that's resulted to a lot of negativity or pessimism in terms of the earnings prospects of these consumer companies. And rightfully so, perhaps early on this year, we saw evidence of weakness. However, there are companies out there with very strong brands and were able to raise prices over the last 2 or 3 years. URC has raised prices by more than double digit over the last few years. And I don't think they'll be, well, and the implications when inflation comes down is fairly good margins for them. Maybe not to generalize all companies for sectors, but there are a lot of opportunities in terms of investing into undervalued high quality companies. And that's what we're all about. It's finding these opportunities to invest in these high quality, strong brand names that present either a sizable uptick in asset value or realization of those asset values or a significant re-rating of earnings, which I think is going to happen for those companies I mentioned earlier.
I'm happy that June mentioned the telcos. So it's also the first one really that I'm monitoring and looking at. So I think at least all three incumbents in the space, all of them had better than expected first quarter figures. And I think there are also catalysts that could propel their share prices higher. So for example, as June mentioned, the IPO of Mint for, in the case of Globe, for PLDT, they're looking to unlock value in terms of their data centers. And even for Converge, at least the rollout of their fiber connection, the fiber service has really picked up also from the first quarter. And I think the good thing about the telcos is they're coming off from long consolidations at the bottom of their patterns, so like maybe 2 or 3 years. They were darlings of the pandemic, and then they kind of just slept there. And then now they're beginning to wake up. I like the fact that at least the two of them, they pay very hefty dividends. So at least that protects your downside in case the market doesn't rally as we were expecting. And the other sector that I like is power. So it also has that defensive element that's out there, and dividend yields are also pretty sizable, and I'm betting on a potential uptick on these names if ever the rate cuts come, just because of the dividend spread and differential versus interest rates. And I think from a valuation standpoint, you have companies also like FGEN that are trading at 4 to 5 times their earnings. So it's just the problem is liquidity, definitely. Yeah, but you have very good, attractively priced, stable earnings companies in the power space. So that's another sector that that we like at the moment.
Yeah, and I think also, right now there are a lot of companies that are putting up data centers. So that said, demand for power will continue to be there, benefiting these power companies. So although it's defensive, there's also this growth angle brought about by, these data centers. So yeah, plus the cash dividends, as you had mentioned. Okay, so with that, thank you very much for your thoughts, June and Serge, on the stock market, on, a recap of what happened in the first half and what to look forward to in the second half of the year. Thank you so much.
Welcome, April.
Thanks,
Thank
April.
you.